Hello and welcome to the Devoted Outdoorsman Podcast.
Hello, Podcast Nation. What is up? I hope you guys are having a great week. It has been very humid and very hot here in Oklahoma this week, so you know that sucks. But you know it's part of getting closer to deer season, getting closer to hunting season. So this week on the podcast, we have a pretty awesome guest. His name is Casey Higley. And he is by far one of the best taxidermists I've ever seen. Like, some of his work is completely beautiful. The animals look like they're still alive. So I'm going to have him on the podcast today. We're going to talk a little bit about how he got introduced into taxidermy, and we're going to see where this thing goes. So, Casey, how did you get introduced into taxidermy?
Well, first off, thank you very much for having me on the podcast tonight. Yeah, I'll go on with that story, but it's crazy. Hot and humid there, and Saturday morning we woke up, it was 26 degrees at our house.
26 degrees, man. I think it barely got 26 degrees here in December.
Yeah, our greenhouse, we left the door open on the greenhouse, and it was at 32.7 degrees. We almost lost all our tomatoes, so we got lucky. But back to the topic, so how I got into taxidermy. Well, my father's a taxidermist. And I was interested in my whole life. When I was in kindergarten, when you sign up what you want to be when you grow up, you know, most people put they want to be an astronaut or a doctor or a veterinarian. I put I wanted to be a taxidermist. And by heck, I am. I'm living what I wanted to be. I started doing taxidermy when I was 9 years old. I mounted, starlings and, you know, sparrows, things like that. Went up to working on pigeons, and then I mounted, I think I was 10 when I mounted my first half-life-size raccoon.
A half-life-size raccoon?
Yep. Open-mouth, half-life-size raccoon. Pretty ambitious. I trapped as a child as well. My dad, he trapped way, way back before I was born, but I found some old traps in our shed, and I decided when I turned 9 I wanted to trap, and I trapped, you know, I trapped muskrats, raccoons, foxes, things like that. But it was the first raccoon I ever trapped, so I decided I wanted to mount it. And I still have it. It hangs in my house, and people shake their head and say, why do you have that ugly thing? For me, it shows me where I came from. It was the first mammal I ever mounted, and now I'm, you know, I'm in the master's division. I'm a master's taxidermist in, you know, big game and mammals, and actually waterfowl and birds as well, but I mainly focus on big game in my shop.
I saw you posted on Facebook that you had recently won some awards.
Yeah, I did. I'm on the board for the Idaho Taxidermy Association, and this last weekend was our show. And for the show, I don't compete for any of the major awards I used to, and I've seen I'm part of the association. I don't do that. When I get out of the association in Utah, start competing for all the major awards. But yeah, I put in what's called the commercial division. I grabbed an elk from one of my clients' houses. I put it in the commercial division, and there's only two things I could win with that. I could win a first place, you know, first place in the commercial division, and then taxidermist choice best elk. So, you know, all the taxidermists that are competing walk around, they see what they feel is the best elk, and then they vote on it. And you know, I think there was only 6 elk or 7 elk at the competition, but I won best elk plus, you know, first place in the commercial division. And then also we did what's called a 3-hour deer challenge where you get up with a bunch of other taxidermists and you do a challenge. You have 3 hours to mount a mule deer, and then they put them out on the floor, and then everyone judges, you know, all the taxidermists, people that are just walking around, and pick who did the best, you know, deer. It could be whitetail or mule deer, the best deer in those 3 hours, and I won that challenge as well.
So you can do a mount in 3 hours on a, like a mule deer or a whitetail?
Yeah, it's not like from start to finish. What it is you have your form, and it's all prepped, you know, all sanded. You made sure your hide fits good. You've got the antlers attached to it. And then you have your cape there prepped, so, you know, you've sewed all the holes in your cape, and you've worked on the ears and stuff, and all we had to do is put ear liners or Bondo if you do Bondo ears, you know, just put, you know, make your ear look like an ear again, and then sculpt all the clay work on the eyes and the nose and the lips, and then glue it up and put the whole deer together, you know, and sew it up. And yeah, in 3 hours, I was on a time crunch taking time out of my shop. So I mounted an antelope and a deer in those 3 hours really quick. I had to come back and really tune the antelope after the competition was over. I rolled the deer out into the competition area for them to judge it. And then I went back and spent a couple hours on the antelope to really make it look nice in the back room.
Yeah, because I was about to say, I know some people wait like a year to get their animal back. So if it takes 3 hours, they might just be better off driving up there to you.
Yeah, no, it's definitely, my shop's turnaround right now is about 9 months. You know, that's anything. Right now we're taking in a lot of bears. I took in 7 bears last week alone. I do 30 bears a year that come in the spring, you know, for life size and rugs and shoulder mounts and things. But then, you know, in the fall, there's days that I'll take in 20 to 30 deer in one day. And so my shop, I try to be under a year, but the tannery takes about 6 months. So, you know, I send all my hides off to be commercially tanned. They're tanned, they come back, and then, you know, when I get going on a deer, I can get one all mounted up, you know, in about, you know, from start to finish, where I've got to take the tanned hide, but then prep the hide, and then prep the form and set the horns on the form and put it together. It takes me about 4 or 5 hours. I'll do 2 deer a day usually in my shop, you know, in an 8 to 10 hour period. And then they dry for 2 weeks, and then you got to do the epoxy and paint. And it takes me about an hour to do epoxy and paint on one deer, and then they're ready to go out the door.
So you're from Idaho, correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I live in southeast Idaho, but I have people ship me work from all over, and I ship work all over. I'm actually getting ready to – I just emailed a gentleman. I've got 5 bears. I've got 1 life size, a half life size, and 3 rugs that are going to Hawaii next week. I just shipped to Michigan, to Nebraska, Colorado, and Florida. I shipped some elk and deer out to those states. I've got two African safaris. I just emailed a lady that needed to go head back to Montana where she lives. She lives on the Montana-North Dakota border. So, yeah, I'm in Idaho, but I do work for people all over the country.
So you're shipping a bear, a life-size bear, to Hawaii?
Yes, a life-size, a half-life-size, and 3 rugs.
So how do you go about shipping something like that, like a big box, I'm assuming?
See, the great thing is for all the stuff in the lower 48, I have a shipper that ships for quite a few different taxidermists. He comes to my shop, he picks up the animals, and he delivers them to my client's door and helps them put them in their house. So that's great for the lower 48 stuff. If it's got to go out of country, which I've got a mountain lion that's got to go to Finland this next fall, and then, you know, like – Hawaii has their own shipping company. It's called Honolulu Freight, and they've got a place down in Salt Lake City, Utah, which I'm only about an hour and a half from Salt Lake. So I'll take and transport all the bears down to Honolulu Freight in Salt Lake, and then they'll do the boxing and they'll ship them across the ocean. So I don't have to worry about that part.
Yeah, I could only imagine, you know, what everything you'd have to go through to ship something to Hawaii. I just feel like that's crazy. But I guess you got to do it, so.
Yep, it's a logistics nightmare, but it's good that they're shipping companies like that. You know, I can just drive the animals down, roll them into their you know, their facility there and say, hey, here you go. Here's the contact information for my clients, and they'll take care of it from there, which is great.
So I can only imagine how many, you know, black bears and stuff you get this time of year being in Idaho. You guys have like you guys can shoot multiple black bear in one season, if I'm not misunderstood.
Yes, there are certain areas you can kill 2 bears in, or if you do if you draw one of the special tags, which we only, as far as I remember off the top of my head, I think we only have 2 draw areas in the entire state of Idaho anyway. But if you draw one of those areas, then you can buy a general tag for the rest of the state. And then there's very few areas that you cannot hunt bears in Idaho. It's pretty much the southern part, like southeast part, right where I live. I'm actually the closest place where I hunt bears. It's 100 miles from my house. So there's not bears in this area, but it's funny. I do a lot of bears. I think I've taken 12 in from Alberta, Canada this year from, you know, different hunters. You know, some from Utah, some from Idaho, some from other states, you know, that have shipped them to me from Alberta. And so I do bears from all over. I've got Alaska bears, Quebec bears, Idaho bears, Montana, Wyoming, Colorado bears all in my shop right now.
So what's the weirdest thing that you've ever had to mount?
Weirdest or rarest? Oh, I gotta think. I've mounted a lot of different things. Weirdest would probably, way back when, about 15 years ago, I used to do a lot of fish and things, and I had a lady bring me some eels that were her pets. And I did those eels. I guess, you know, that would be the weirdest. It's not, definitely not the coolest animal. You know, I've worked on everything from, you know, I've contracted out with another taxidermist and helped them do things like elephants and giraffes and things like that. And in my shop, I've done pretty much everything under the sun in Africa as well. You know, I do about 60 African animals a year, but, you know, just rarest would probably, I don't know, rarest would be like a Lord Derby eland or something like that.
So you helped do an elephant. That seems like that would be a big chore.
They are a big chore. Yes. Yeah. The bigger, you know, those are things you need a forklift for and a big, you know, 20-foot tall shop, things like that, which I have here and I can do all that here.
So what's it cost to get an elephant mounted or like a life-size mount of an elephant?
You're looking upwards of $65,000.
Oh, so somewhere up there is what I was thinking, because, you know, that's got to take so much time. But, I mean, hey, you can do a deer in 3 hours. So, I mean, that's pretty good. Where you get an elephant done in, like, 20?
No, a lot longer than that. It takes, you know what I mean? It takes a long time with four or five guys working on one.
Yeah, I can only imagine. I'm sure it's, like, weeks and months worth of work.
Yeah, it is. There's no hair, hardly any hair on an elephant, so you can't hide anything. You know, you gotta epoxy all your seams, all your sewing, where with a deer, you sew them up and the hair covers it.
Yeah, I can only imagine all the things, cause like, I work in the automotive industry. I do auto body repair and stuff like that. So I can see imperfections in my work. So like when I do work, I can see the imperfection, but no one else will ever see it. So I'm sure it's the same way when it comes to taxidermy. I'm sure there's certain things that you see that no one else will ever see, and it probably just bugs the crap out of you.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, it drives me crazy. I mean, it just drives me crazy. But you can only be good if you're your hardest critic. You got to be your hardest critic.
And that's what I try to tell myself all the time. I always tell myself, you know, they'll never see it. They don't even care. And half the time, customers don't even look at their car. They're just, you know, oh, okay. And they hop in and they drive off. But, you know, that means, I guess that means it passed the look test. You know, they looked at it. They said, okay, it's good enough and left. But with an elephant, yep. I feel like it would probably be a little bit more, you know, in depth.
Yes.
So when it comes to, like velvet on antlers or like on an animal, what's the procedure you should take if you, let's say you harvested a mule deer, you know, in like September or something, like when it's still semi warm outside, what type of procedure should you go through to take care of that properly?
Okay. So, you know, velvet's a tricky thing. It really is. Velvet, you treat it like a baby. Whenever I harvest an animal in velvet, you know how everyone wants to do the grip and grin, grab a hold of the antlers and swing it around and get all the pictures. That's a big no-no with velvet. Grab it by the bottom of the jaw, you know, or by the ears and get all the pictures you want that way. Just leave the velvet alone. Your hands are warm, they're sweaty, they're oily. You grab that velvet and it starts to rub the velvet off and it gets bacteria growing on the velvet because, you know, I know Idaho, it starts August 30th. You know, for our deer hunt. And then we have an early season rifle elk hunt that starts August 1st. So we have elk in the velvet. The bull that I won those awards on this week was a full velvet, 7x6 bull elk. And so velvet's very, very tricky to work with. So what I suggest for a hunter, they go, they shoot their animal. Like I said, grab a hold of the ears, the head, you know, to move around, take the picture. Don't grab the grip and grin. Don't grab a hold of your antlers and be sliding them around. And then, you know, when you go to pack the thing out, skin it off and then put it in your backpack. Don't be grabbing it by the antlers and dragging it to the truck. It's just, you're going to destroy the velvet. Best thing, keep it cool and dry and get it to a freezer or your taxidermist as soon as possible so they can take care of it from there.
And that's what I've always heard, is to be very gentle with it and to get it as cold as possible, as fast as possible. But, you know, here in Oklahoma, we don't have a season where you can harvest, you know, animals with velvet. So it's just kind of one of those questions that I've always had. I've also heard, like, not saline, but, like, salt and water to put in there. But I've only heard that from a handful of people. I'm not sure if that's something that actually works or not.
I would highly suggest against salt and water. They have, you can go through taxidermy supply companies and you can get what's called velvet preserve. And you can inject your antlers, or you can get formaldehyde, which is very dangerous, but it's by far better than, in my opinion, than the antler preserve. But it's, you know, a lot more toxic, and you can inject it that way. You know, wear gloves, wear a face mask, at least, you know, glasses, so you don't get it in your eyes. It will make you go blind. But, you know, what I usually do is I have most all my antlers freeze-dried. So I'll send them to my clients. I think I took in 18 deer in velvet, and then I took in the one bull elk this year in velvet. So I'll put them all in my freezer, and then I'll take them to a freeze dryer that I've got, a local freeze dryer, and he freeze dries all my velvet for me. I think it gives it a better look, in my opinion, than injecting them.
Okay, cool. So you said you mentioned your freezer quite often. So how big is this freezer that you have?
I've got, you know, just those, what are they, 22 cubic foot freezers or whatever they are, the big, big chest freezers. I've got five of those.
Oh, okay. So it's not like a giant room or anything like that.
No. I've just got five chest freezers.
Perfect. What is the animal in your profile picture on Facebook?
Oh, that's an ibex.
Go ahead.
What's that? Oh, that's a mid-Asian ibex. There's 12 subspecies of ibex that I can think of off the top of my head. I could be wrong. There could be more. But just off the top of my head, thinking of the different subspecies, there's 12 of them around the world.
So did you have to go to Asia to harvest that animal?
Yeah, I went to Kyrgyzstan.
Kyrgyzstan is. I have no idea, but I can already tell you it's probably a crazy experience.
Yes. You know, I've hunted my entire life, and I've hunted all over, you know, I've been to Alaska and all over the West and parts of the Midwest, and, you know, I've hunted whitetails, and in Nebraska, I do that every year, so, you know, just north of you guys in Kansas, and then I've hunted all over, you know, the West, from Washington to California to, you know, Arizona and all this place, and yeah, it's a total different world, literally total different world over there in Asia. It's like flying into the 1950s.
So what were the main hurdles that you had to jump through? Were there any big problems, like you importing your stuff over there or bringing it back or anything like that?
Not really. You know, Asia's good for that, where, you know, countries in Africa, you can't bring them back with you. You've got to wait, you know, and then it's got to be shipped to you, which, you know, like South Africa, Namibia, Zimbabwe, they've got it down to a science where they get your animals back to you, but it takes like 8-9 months. With me, you know, there was a few hurdles. I got there, you know, just fine. We got our ibex. There were some issues with guides, and, you know, they didn't speak any English, so we didn't, you know, speak to anyone English that spoke English for 12 days. But when we got back to the airport to come home, I had my ibex with me, and they didn't have the permit for me to have an ibex, so they took it at the airport. So it's like me going deer hunting in Oklahoma and not having a tag, kind of equivalent. So they have, but at least over there, it's not like over here where you get poaching, you're going to, you know, not be able to hunt and you'll never get your animal. What happened there is they, you know, they figured out the paperwork and then they shipped it to me, and I had it in like a month. So my brother went about a year after I went. He went last January, and he brought his home. You know, they had all the paperwork, so he had it in his duffel bag. You know, he had the skin and the horns in his duffel bag, and he brought it back from Kyrgyzstan all the way to Salt Lake City Airport, and I've got it from there.
So was that like a dream hunt that you'd always kind of dreamed of going on, or?
You know, I seen a picture of an ibex in an old religious book, an old church book, back, what was I, maybe 7 or 8 years old, and I told my dad, one day I'm going to hunt those. Everyone laughed at me. And it took me till I was 33 years old before I could finally afford it and be able to, you know, save the pennies to go, and I did it.
So did you harvest that animal with a rifle or with a bow?
I harvested it with a, I built a, you know, it's funny because everyone, you know, you go ibex hunting, they say your average shot's about 450 to 500 yards. You know, I shoot long distance out here in, you know, Idaho. It's open western country. You know, I've hunted a lot of antelope. It's, but I was like, I'm going to specifically build a rifle for this hunt. So I got a Remington Mall 700 long range edition in 7mm Magnum. And then I put a loophole CDS, you know, the custom dial system scope on it. Was shooting out to 1,000 yards with it. And then I ended up getting there, and I shot the ibex at 48 yards.
So you did all this preparation, built a gun and everything for a chip shot.
Everything for a shot, I would have been very comfortable with my bow. Because I, you know, I don't hunt out to 120 yards, but I shoot in my yard out to 120 yards every day with my bow just for fun. So, you know, 48-yard shot with my bow, I'm very, very confident in making that shot. I shot it with a rifle.
Well, at least you got, at least you still have the gun.
yep, exactly.
So what are some of the issues that you see people doing when they harvest an animal and they bring it to you, whether that be like they cape it wrong, maybe cut it too high, or, you know, don't properly take care of the skin, something like that?
That's a huge thing. Improper care of skin. And, you know, I've got on both my Facebook, Instagram page, and my website, and I text it to people all the time, just a simple diagram of how to skin an animal. You're planning on going on a hunt. I mean, even you go hunting in your backyard for a big whitetail, you kill a 170-inch whitetail. To me, that's a huge whitetail. We don't have that big a whitetail in Idaho. You know, you kill that whitetail like that, you want it done right. You don't want to ruin the cape. So it's just like preparing for a hunt. You shoot your bow, you shoot your gun, you set your tree stands, being, you know, where you're at in Oklahoma, and you get pictures, but then you don't talk to your taxidermist and figure out the best way to get the animal prepared. You know, you spend tens of thousands of dollars to hunt, and then once the animal's on the ground, you have no idea what to do with it to preserve the best trophy. You know, the what you want the trophy preserved. And so the big thing is study that. Learn where you should cut because, yeah, there's many a time the brisket's completely cut off and the cape's useless, and you have to throw it away and you have to buy a new cape. You know, I buy capes for multiple outfitters around here, so I've always got capes on hand, but it's always better to use your own personal cape from the animal you harvest.
Yes, several years ago, my little brother harvested it's never been officially scored, but I'm guessing around one high 130s, low 140s whitetail, which is it's a decent buck, it's a solid buck here in Oklahoma. So he harvested it, and we were kind of looking at it, and I was like, so are you going to want to try to mount this or not? And he's like, no, I think I'm just going to get a European mount. So I was like, all right. So we just started cutting, and then the next day he had decided that he thinks he wants to go ahead and get it mounted. So we actually had to hunt down a cape somewhere. But I don't remember exactly where he ended up finding it, if the taxidermist he used actually had it or if he bought it from someone.
You know, I've probably got 10 mule deer capes, 6 or 7 elk capes, and, you know, whitetail are so different. You know, I've got a few Idaho, Montana area whitetails. I've got a few Nebraska whitetails and a few east, you know, northeast whitetail capes because, you know, it depends on where you shoot a whitetail. They are totally different. I think I've got a couple South Texas whitetails in my freezer, too, just as extra capes. But that's, you know, it's always better because gets more expensive when you have to buy a cape from the taxidermist because, you know, he had to buy it from an outfitter or a different client or something like that. And so people, they get mad. They're like, well, I ruined my cape, but I don't want to buy a new one. Well, that's what you kind of have to do because I bought it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And most of the time they're probably trying to make a couple of dollars off of it too.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. You know, you've got to upcharge. For me, you know, I don't do much of an upcharge. It's usually 10% is all. From what I pay, you know, I pay the person for a cape. I usually charge 10% on top of that to a client. So it's not a whole lot, but I feel that's my time to make phone calls to the outfitters to see if they've got capes. You know, my time to talk to, pick it up, or have it, you know, brought into my shop so I can take care of it.
So what do you think the average price on a, let's say a mule deer, well, you know, similar to a whitetail, let's say a mule deer, what is the price in your area for a mule deer mount, like a shoulder mount?
Shoulder mount? The mm-hmm. price in my area or my price? That's
well,
two totally different things.
Well, I'm assuming your price is going to be a little bit higher, but you're paying for the quality of the work. You are an award-winning taxidermist, so you have the right to charge more than, you know, someone that's doing it
yeah,
in their garage.
In our area, we've got guys that charge as little as $350. I think the going rate's about $700, and I'm in the $750 to $800 range is where I'm at in my area. So that's for a basic shoulder mount, not like a wall pedestal or a pedestal. It goes up from there.
That's what they're going for around here. You know, on the low end, like you're saying, around $350, you know, there's a lot of people that pop up every year that, you know, they got 2 week turnarounds and, you know, $350 and, you know, next year they'll be gone. That's why I always tell people, you know, I get people asking me questions every year. Hey man, have you heard anything about this guy? Or hey man, what do you think about this? I was like, well, how long are they saying that they're going to have until you have it back to you? If they say 2 weeks, I'm kind of iffy. You know, I'm not saying it's not possible, but it's unlikely that everything's getting done, you know, correctly. And from my knowledge.
Yeah, to me, not just incorrectly, but if you're getting it done in 2 weeks, that means you don't have anything to do. You know what I mean? You don't have any workload in your shop as a taxidermist. That means you're in trouble. If you're starving for work, there's issues in your business. You know that with cars. If you don't have cars to work on, you're in trouble. If someone's screaming, yeah, I'll get it done in 2 weeks because they have nothing to do. Where guys, you know, I think I've taken in close to 80 African animals since February. Then I've taken in, you know, 20 some odd bears already this spring. And then, you know, everything from the fall is just, it's a revolving circle. There's always work here. If I get to where I can, where I would have to do something in 2 weeks to get a paycheck to provide for my family, I'd be in trouble. I feel.
Yeah. And the thing I see with them is it's always somebody that I'm sure they took a class and, you know, this is probably their first year doing it, but also, you know, that's okay because those are people that are trying to learn and at least they're, you know, they're pricing their the quality for their skill level. You know, they're pricing it, you know, $350. They're like, hey, you know, I'm just starting out. I'm trying to do the best I can. But then at the same time, we had in the recent years here in the state, we had a couple people that were kind of scamming people that were like, hey, you know, $500 and you'll take a year to get your deer back. And then, you know, the deer and the $500 is gone or not 500, you know, their deposit, whatever it may be.
Yeah. That's a bad thing too. You call them fly by night taxidermist. It happens everywhere. It's sad. This industry's got a lot of, you know, a lot of flack. You hear it all the time. Well, how long have you been in business? You know, things like that. Well, I started taxidermy. I got my own business license when I was 16 years old. I'm 36 now. You know, I run a full-time shop. I provide for 4 children and a wife. My wife is a stay-at-home, you know, mom. That's a full-time job in itself. So, you know, guys like me, guys that are full-time, they're not going anywhere with your stuff because it's their full-time job. They're not doing it part-time for their beer money. The priority is not to go fishing with their buddies on, you know, on a weeknight and drink beer. The priority is to get their job done for their clients so they can provide for their families.
I agree with that 100%, man. And I just wanted to tell you that I really appreciate you taking your time out of your evening to talk to me, you know, a little bit about taxidermy, give me a couple tips, and the listeners a couple tips. The velvet thing was something I've been very interested about for the past few years. You know, I keep asking anyone that I feel like would have some knowledge on it, and I definitely figured you would. So you said that you can buy a kit online. Do you know any name brands that sell that or just?
Yes. Uh-huh. You can go to McKenzie Taxidermy Supply Company, Google that. They'll have what's called velvet can or velvet preserve, and there'll be instructions on the bottle. So you got, you know, or you can go to True Fit Lifeforms. That's another taxidermy company, or there's a lot of them out there. You just Google taxidermy supply company there'll be a bunch of names that come out. Mackenzie, I throw out Mackenzie because they're the biggest company. They've got warehouses all over the country. They've got one in Ogden, Utah, which is only about 60, 80 miles from my house. And, you know, they're out of South Carolina, so they've got places everywhere.
All right, Mackenzie's. And I think everyone that is looking in the future to go on any type of velvet hunt should definitely look into that, because I would hate for you to spend all the money to get out there and harvest this animal and, you know, mess up the trophy that you're wanting to take home. With that being said, Casey, where can people find your website and your Facebook page and stuff like that? Where does that go from? What is the name of that?
Okay, so my website, you know, I'm horrible with websites. My website doesn't get updated near as much as, say, Instagram or Facebook, but my website is wildrivertaxidermy.org. You can find me under Casey Higley or Wild River Taxidermy on Facebook. And then the one that's got all, you know, it's just dedicated to my taxidermy business is my Instagram page, which is wild_river_taxidermy on Instagram. And that's, you know, I'm throwing pictures up usually once a day, if not two times a day, of my work. And you guys can contact me through there. You know, I'm free to help anybody. If someone has questions, give me a call, give me an instant message, and I'll, you know, try to help people out as much as I can.
And I feel like, you know, I wanted to have a taxidermist on, and I felt like you were the right guy because, I don't know, you might have heard about it. This year in the state of Oklahoma, we had, well, George Moore, which is the official Boone and Crockett Pope and Young scorer, one of them for Oklahoma, he scored, I think it was 38 whitetail over 200 inches that were harvested in the state of Oklahoma this year. And that was just what he scored. That's not counting, you know, what other people had scored, or even the deer that didn't get turned in or didn't get talked about very much. So I can only imagine what's going to happen next year. And I just want people to know the facts, you know, what they need to do, what they need to take care of, and how to do it all.
You know, I just highly suggest do your homework. Find a taxidermist that you like his work. Ask him questions. Pick his brain how he wants you to take care of that animal before you take it to him. You know, you don't go out in the field and go hunting blind. You know, you do your homework before you go hunting. When you get successful, it's better to have done your homework before then. You know, I get hundreds of calls about taxidermy during the hunt that people have never talked to me. They don't know what a good price is, what a bad price is, what a good mount is, what a bad mount is. They have no idea. They just have a monster buck or bull laying on the ground, and they're like, oh, crap, now I need to do something with it. It's always better to do your homework first.
I agree with that 100%. Well, thank you very much, and I hope you have a great evening.
You as well. Have a good evening.